on various other types of game theory things and economic studies. People might be familiar with the prisoner's dilemma. The snowdrift dilemma is a slight variation, and we can go into the details. There's actually a page on our site explaining it, but I'm going to skip right to the snowdrift dilemma, which says basically there's a big drift of snow blocking the road, and you have to get through, and maybe some other people have to get through. Also, typical game setup is there's two people, but the question is, who's going to do the work? So if you go ahead and get to work, and the other people are lazy or busy with other things, then you have to do it all on yourself, and that kind of stinks. But if you have other things to do, you could wait and then see maybe other people will do it. And if the other people do it, then the road will get clear, and that means you get to do other things, and that's sort of the optimal selfish result. Mm-hmm. Not that everybody's selfish, but if you're aiming for your own best interest in this game, that's your goal. But if both people have that goal, then both people wait, and we don't get anything happening. And everybody's stuck there. And that's the worst case. So what happens in most situations is that somebody feels like they care about having the thing at least good enough. So they get to work, and they get it done, sort of. It's what you get with only one person doing it instead of a better result you get with both people. It's not as nice, it's not as fair as if everybody cooperated together. But whoever kind of needed it done first ends up doing the work. So unlike the prisoner's dilemma, it can lead to things happening. It's not quite as impossible to get over, but it's not a great situation because if everybody cooperated, that's really the best world. So overall, this is like free software funding. We have competition from proprietary things. We have people making choices about being restrictive and proprietary. We have people using or funding proprietary development, and we have people choosing to do different things with their time than working on free software. And obviously the people here are often the people who are choosing to come and work on the free software. And our problem isn't that we're not doing our part, it's that we don't have enough other people helping us. We need to get more people to fund us or to make our funding for our work not be somehow dependent on proprietary stuff, like how Mozilla gets all their funding from Google, which gets all their funding from proprietary stuff, even though they do some free software. So there's a lot of different ways to do this, and we're building a site called snowdrift.coop, which is our proposed system to address this dilemma, in which basically each month I will say that I'll pledge some very small amount, minimum would be a tenth of a cent, but we'll go like a penny, for every, well, in this case would be, this is actually our old slide, we changed our formula, but we're saying, it, like a network effect, I will match everybody else. So I will chip in each month a tenth of a cent for everybody else who's with me. That type of pledge addresses this dilemma because it says, I'm not going to just do it on my own. I'm going to tell you that I will do my part if you come and join me. And so the uncomfortable part is to actually say to somebody, you might have $100 you want to support some developer with, maybe don't just give it to them, maybe tell the rest of the world that you'll match them and invite them to come join you, because I don't have a lot of money, and if you chip in all that you can to this project, I'm happy that you did, and maybe I'm going to keep my little bits of money that I have because you already donated, and whether I donate or not doesn't change what you do. So it doesn't, if all my extra $10 does is $10. I lose $10, they get $10. Issue with free software and proprietary and everything else doesn't change. What changes is if we have a critical mass and everybody works together, and that's how you get a network effect. So the more people who pledge together, the more funding the project will get, the more each person will chip in. And we have some formulas on that, and the site is built with YSOD, which is Haskell-based web framework, and we're AGPL. And so the idea is to run it as a cooperative, and we have three member classes, which is the people working on the site itself, the people who are working on projects that want to get funded, who want to make a living working on free software or free cultural works, and the people who want those things to succeed, who want to support them. So at a very simple level, one of the reasons I'm here, although I have other things I could say about Debian, is that I'm interested in getting people who want to help with any of these three things. At this point, we're not launched yet, but we have a site in progress and we need help building it. We could also want to talk to people who want funding, and we want to talk to projects who want to talk to us about how we can best serve their needs. And you can help support us even, or if you want to. We're actually thinking of running a traditional one-time fund drive at some point to just help us get lunch. But that's basically it. There's a simple summary. The site is live at snowdrift.coop, and you can, right, screen isn't fully on here, but you can check it out. We have a lot of research, and I've also looked a lot into the existing sites. So for example, we went out and actually said, I don't like wheel reinvention, by the way. I really wish that everybody would coordinate together and work on things that we all need and help the things that are already existing do better. So I felt it was our duty to look at all the existing things before we just throw up yet another site. So we actually did, if you're curious about any of these things, we actually made a summary after looking at all 700 existing crowdfunding sites. And so we have there's the ones that do the one-time things. They don't actually solve our solution because they're all one-time. There's a bunch of hype and it's just a little more marketing. It's like a excuse to hassle your friends. And it had a certain place, just getting going. But actually most of the stuff on, say, Kickstarter tends to be proprietary. Anyway, there's bounty systems, which there's 12 of them that have failed. These are the ones that are still around. Yeah, there's reasons that type of system has its place, but it's not really a great solution. And then there's ransom systems people have used in cases. And then we're a subscription type of a site. You may be aware of what used to be called GitTip is now GratitPay. There's a lot of sites that say, hey, it would be great if we all just sort of ongoing support people to have a living, but it doesn't solve the snowdrift dilemma. It just says one person donating, that's it. It doesn't really invite anybody else, doesn't grow the community necessarily. So there's nobody doing anything quite like what we're doing, but there's a lot of great stuff out there and there's a lot of challenges. So I can go into a lot of detail about how we chose the different things that we chose and where we are right now. But I'm going to leave it at that and say that's the basic idea, and I'd like anybody to tell me your first impressions or questions. And yeah, go ahead. And if there's a mic, I guess, here.
How do you choose how to allocate funds to the projects?
That's a great question, and I understand there was a session about that earlier this week regarding Debian is not one of the projects that currently is lacking in funds, at least in terms of they're not going through them all, they have funds and they're not sure how to spend them. That is a slightly different dilemma than the one we're focusing on. So our focus is on existing projects that are not trying to do some new dream thing, although we could expand to that at some point. I'll go ahead and tell you something specific about the Debian-related, my personal story in all of this and getting into free software, which is that when I got frustrated enough with a lot of proprietary stuff and ads and things back in the beginning of 2012, I have a music background, actually, and I was coming to this from a free culture sort of side of things. And I decided to try a Linux system and figure out what I could do for music. And after a lot of looking around, I ended up with a system called KX Studio. And for those of you who are not familiar with it, basically there's this set of repositories and packages and additional tools that are extremely user-friendly, for the Linux world at least, that are all built on extras for Debian. So basically, anybody running Debian can add the KX Studio repositories to your system, and you will have the latest up-to-date, all of these 500 and whatever audio plugins and 30 or 40 different great audio softwares and a whole bunch of other things, and this suite called Cadence, which helps update the whole thing and keep the system running. Now, it still took me a little while to get used to this idea and get into Linux and everything, and I was asking for help and kind of got comfortable with the community a little bit, and I now personally, in some sense, over the internet, know the guy who actually is behind KX Studio. And he is a guy who something 5 years ago had no idea about any of this stuff, picked up a book on Python and decided to learn to program, and he lives in Portugal, and he doesn't know any other programmers, and somehow he became one of the most significant gurus in understanding the whole Linux audio world, and making sense of it all and packaging it and then making this totally accessible downstream thing. And currently he lives with his grandparents and he's basically unemployed and poor, and he lives in Portugal and makes something like 2,000 euros a year in donations. And he could do a lot more if he, it would probably be good for him not to stress out about basic living things, and it would be nice if he could support a number of other people who are trying to do some other things or get other help. And he doesn't have a question of how he would spend his money. He's literally like, I would get some nicer groceries. So there are people who donate to what he's doing, but it's a question of growing the community again. And that's actually just one example. But I have other examples like that. So we're, that's a great project for us. When we get launched, he's going to be signed up, and we're going to try to get some extra funding for him to do what he can do. And he told me basically that if he got to something like, I don't know, 10,000 euros a year or something like that, he would be like, wow, this is fantastic. I can like donate to other upstream projects and things. So people have different, there's a lot of different levels of where people are at with funding. And there's a lot of space where there's clear need. I guess I should answer your question more specifically though. Our system is designed so that we say, you're a project, you probably should keep it within a small enough frame, so not Debian as a project probably, but some smaller projects that we'd actually have a focus. And we identify on site who are like the project team, the people who are getting paid, and it's gonna be you saying, I'm somebody who works on this, this exists, and I either have a day job doing something that is proprietary, so working against the goals of free software, or is otherwise something I don't really want to do, and I'd like to spend more of my time on this, but I need to get a basic living to do that. And that's the sort of people we're trying to fund. And so if we can succeed at funding some people like that, we'll dabble with all the other things. But as an ongoing system, like a monthly goal, the idea is you report your expenses and your revenue on the system so that the patrons can know what the status is. And then people can keep projects accountable. You can say, I see this over this 3 months, this project really made good use of their funds, I'm going to keep supporting them or off my pledge or something. And if they didn't, you can pull your pledge.
Do the patrons choose where the money's allocated, or do you have some sort of advisory group that chooses how to allocate things? Or?
Yeah. So the formula is, the system is, project gets listed on the site, patrons, at least this is actually a bigger, broader question that we have to deal with legally, but the actual facilitation of funds, but proposal at this point is basically you put your funds in an escrow type of account where it's your funds, but in the system it says you have this much, and you make a pledge to the projects you choose to support. And then within those projects, we have a system to have a discussion. You can say, I want this, but project has some level of autonomy to say, we have this much funds from patrons, we're going to use it as best as we can, but you can pick which projects you want to support.
Is that kind of flatter style?
You could think of it that way. So one way to think of this is, flatter is a way to budget a bunch of funds and then choose how you want to allocate. And we're doing that, except flatter doesn't have the assurance contract, doesn't solve the snowdrift dilemma. Okay. And it's a zero-sum type of a situation. You donate to them, that means the other person gets less. But it's like flatter, having sort of a monthly budget, but the budget goes to the project when other people join you, which is more like Kickstarter in terms of actually having a collective action issue. Except it's not all or nothing. It's not hard, you know. Oh, you didn't hit this goal, you fail. That's how Kickstarter works. It's a little more like it's scalable. But yeah, it's got some similarity to flatter.
Is it possible for patrons to nominate groups, or do groups have to sign up themselves, or?
We haven't. Okay, so I should tell you about the status of the system right now. Right now, you can go on the site and you can sign up and you can play around with the two projects listed on the site, which is the site itself, and the other one is the site that the project I was involved in that is part of the inspiration of what led to the site, which is called Task Coach. Just because I'm involved, I put it up there. We have like in the testing, but it's not live, like forms for projects to sign up. And we have a wiki page of like projects we're interested in talking to, and so a lot of these details aren't figured out yet. We've got a lot of the plans, a lot of the research, but we don't have a site fully operating. So sure, it'd be great to say, I want to support this project. I think we'd need to have the actual project signed up, you know, in order to actually start collecting funds for them.
Yeah, the example you gave is a situation where you probably want to nominate that.
Right. But site. I go to Felipe and say, hey, I know you're struggling, and like, I don't have a lot of money, and I donated a little bit anyway, but I know that doesn't do much because it's just my $10. But, you know, we're working on this site, and he says, okay, cool, I'll sign up. When tell me when I can sign up. And I also have to figure out international issues about finance. That gets complicated, so I can't promise that when we first launch, we'll be able to send money to Portugal. I just don't want to say that we're doing that right now, but we want to. The actual sign-up process, because we're trying to, I'd say the biggest challenge that we've had by far has been that we made a decision early on that we had to be consistent with our mission. And so every single thing about the site is free software. And so we didn't want to be reliant on GitHub even. So we're a bit mirrored on Gitorious. And when we studied all the different ways you could have tickets and other things that are the features you get with a system like GitHub, for various reasons that relate to mixes of yak shaving and technical choices and whatever else, and I'm not the developer, so I had to defer to people who know more than I do. We ended up building our own discussion system that's connected to our wiki thing that we put tickets on. But we designed it so that every project that signs up will have access to the same things. So basically, we hit all these obstacles and said, like, okay, we're at this point. How do we do that and be totally free software? Right now, we have no analytics on the site because we could use PIWIC, but we just haven't figured that out yet. We're really avoiding JavaScript, actually, because we're doing like progressive enhancement, making sure everything works with NoScript and screen readers and things like that. So, you know, there's all these different tools that if we just popped in some, you know, standard stuff or proprietary thing, or the standard old tools like if we just used MediaWiki or something, that would be not exactly the right tool for us. We have to adapt it, and the developer doesn't like PHP. Anyway, if each of the times along the way we've hit all these obstacles and we did the research and figured out what we could do, and then we said, okay, if we figured out a solution that at least worked for us, we'll make sure it's available to all the projects if they choose to use that. So we've put in a bunch of time recently on getting our discussion ticketing thing kind of operating better, whereas that's not directly getting us launched, but I like it. Maybe it'll work out. It's been a challenge. So I guess the answer to how this relates to the process of nominating projects of who gets involved is like we actually had this idea of saying, here's the list of, this is related to Zach's talk at the plenary, what is, makes a free service, that sort of thing. And so we tried to collect a list of all of the honorable ideals that the best community relating free software projects would do. And then we're asking projects to go through filling out like an honor report thing that just says, here's how we're doing on these things. You know, we have third-party ad trackers on our site, yes or no, or whatever else, so that can be reported to the community and hopefully push projects in that direction. So there's this process we had in mind for how projects would sign up. And we have a few projects in mind, but yeah. Any other questions, any thoughts, anybody have any? If you want to talk about other things related to the economics of free software, this is sort of I've studied it a lot is the point, so I can tell you about our system, but I can also talk about related tangential things.
So I am a member of a cooperative in Brazil. We have 7 years or 8 years of working. Mm-hmm. And so we came together to create a business based on the principle of free software. So everyone who works on the cooperative is also an owner of the company, mm-hmm. except for interns. But our plan is always to make the interns partners after they finish school and spend 1 year with us. And there's also, in Argentina, they have several cooperatives. Free software cooperatives. They even have a a national federation or something at that level. So they actually go lobby governments and stuff like that to prefer free software and everything. And so we are kind of connected with those people. So we are trying to create something like that at the Latin America level,
yeah.
Also. So that I just wanted to point out that that's another alternative for funding. So you can create a business and together with other developers and.
We
are not rich, but
yeah.
At least
tell me what my understanding, and I've talked to a few people involved in different cooperatives in free software.
Mm-hmm.
They are almost entirely all worker co-ops, in my experience. Is that your situation?
Yep.
So I think worker co-ops are a great model. I mean, I like cooperatives in general. The thing that we've been trying to do is what's called a multi-stakeholder cooperative. So I have mixed feelings about how I present this to different audiences, but I'm making some assumptions about the people here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not coming from a developer background. I've been learning Haskell because our site is written in Haskell, and David, who's the lead developer, was like, you can help with some easy things here and there if you study Haskell, so I'm studying Haskell. But I'm not coming from the tech side. I'm coming from I'm a user, I like my privacy, I like having control over my system, I don't like that you have ads on everything and the whole direction of all of that. And I care about free culture issues, so I'm talking about issues of educational resources being available to everybody, things like that. So in my sense, I wasn't actually designing this or thinking about this as the goal is about the funding of the developers, like the developers' interests. I think they're important and I want their interests included. But my thinking is that I'm interested in the public. So the general public, the people who are using the software, they're the interests that I want to serve. And so at some level, it's a means to an end. If we can give people a good economic system to fund free development, then we don't need to fund proprietary development. Or I can say, actually, you can check this out if you're curious, because there's a lot of interesting stuff on the site. But I wrote this up in an article about economics, here, in which
don't see anything
on
the
we lost the thing. Oh, it doesn't really matter. I was just gonna. Anyway. Well, it doesn't matter. I'll tell you. There's an article about economics on the site that describes this, but I'll tell you my thinking of it. This is one way to explain the economics of free software, free culture. There is basically three things that you get when something is proprietary. When you add artificial restrictions to something, make it proprietary. One of them is that it enables certain business models, and they have been proven to be actually pretty effective. Sure, there's a lot of competition, but the amount of money that's given to proprietary software, proprietary cultural works, is quite a ginormous amount of money. The other part of it is that, of course, it gives the people who are in control of it a lot of power over the users, as free software people are aware of. And the third thing is that it excludes people. So if you have a special barrier to access or whatever else, then people who are poor can't use it. So the first example, the idea that it funds you, is a totally legitimate thing. There's nothing unethical about that. It's just that the other two side effects are really horrible. So at some level, our goal is to create an economy that is effective enough to pay people salaries so that we can say, now, because we can show you that you can make a living doing free software, and not in a way where you're doing a little bit of free software so that the company you work for can then make a proprietary project. That's not what I mean. Like really making end user enabling free software. Now you have no excuse. Now if you're still proprietary, then you're just being an asshole. Now you're just trying to gain power and exclude people. But right now, I understand that the free software economics is challenging. And so I know people who are proprietary who are not trying to do so for malicious reasons. And they're trying to do so because they want to make a living. And I sort of say that's a good excuse. I don't want to be dogmatic about it. So I think the main conclusion that I'm trying to get to is that right now we have very supply side economics. And we have people making products, startups coming up with new products, all the traditional stuff, and then as a consumer in the market, and I don't like that word, but it works in this case, you look at what the products are and you get to choose. And that's it. You don't have freedom to really do anything. It's not really serving your interest. They're not really responsive to you. It's this stuff has to compete in the market. So if the thing that is really crappier, you're not going to choose that one. But you only get to choose from what the supply side offers you. And I want to create an economy that's demand side, or at least is more demand side, where the community gets together and says, we as a community want things that serve our interest. We're the ones paying you. We have a cooperative in which we've gotten together. And okay, we've included the developers because we want their perspective too. But our cooperative is the people who are using the technology telling the developers, we have funding, we want to fund you, serve our interests. The goal of this is to be what's good for the community. I don't know, I don't say that too often to somebody who's depending on the audience. I don't feel like that would always go over well.
I work for a nonprofit that is 100% free software, and we are also majority funded by individual users. And one of the things that's been, I think, very useful for us in our funding is to have all the content of our site and our monthly newsletters and our user interfaces and that sort of thing translated into multiple languages.
Sure.
And in order to be able to have users all over the world. And so I would definitely advocate making sure that as you're building
things
that you are ready for that.
So, I don't know, maybe Joey knows more than I do, but there are various systems that do all sorts of stuff, and because, I guess one of the challenges is because we're using the ASOD web framework and the various new tools, it's like there's not a drop-in, this is that translating thing that, you know, they use with MediaWiki or whatever else it is. But yeah, that's absolutely on the list. And we have a number of people who volunteered to do translation for us, but at this point it's literally like, I don't have a good technical thing on the site to be like, you know, here's this language version of whatever. Like, yeah.
Yeah, and we do for some things, but for things like the newsletter, we still rely on just an email list of people sending things back and forth. It's fairly low tech. It would be nice if we had something fancier.
Well, not just the doing the translation, but when it's, when you're, like, how is it presented? How does
I see what you're saying. Yeah.
I'm asking in your case.
Ours is our own custom solution, but it follows standards, and if someone has it set in their browser.
So what's the experience? Somebody goes to the site, and there's just, like, a button that changes different languages, or?
Yeah, like a drop-down that they can select.
And then all
languages.
Stuff on the site.
Or if their browser already has a language preference set, it will do the right thing.
Sure. So we need to implement that. That's definitely a priority, among lots of other priorities. Yeah, Brett.
Do you guys have like a blog or a news page to follow along with progress?
What the heck? Okay, so
to keep up with the developments.
Yeah, so the back when I don't know a year ago or something, when I was like, we need a wiki to put all this stuff down. You know, I debated with all these things, and we found even that there is like can't think of the name of it right now, but there's a wiki written in Haskell even, but it's GPLv2 only. And so that won't work without, we can't use it directly, because we're AGPL, and anyway, license compatibility. So we ended up throwing up our own wiki thing, and then we ended up throwing up a discussion thing, and we have a system that I feel really great about kind of moderating things and keeping everybody being really respectful, which is basically if you post something that violates the code of conduct, somebody can hit flag on it, that it sends you a message that just says, please edit your thing and fix it and make it more respectful and then keep it there, rather than some sort of zero tolerance, you know, thing. And so we were trying to think about, okay, what should we do for an email list? There's tons of people who would be benefiting from an email list, and it was like somebody could put up a mailman thing. Whatever, it doesn't integrate with everything else. I don't know. Anyway, at the moment, the status is we're going to try to keep everything all in one system on the site, because there's a lot of advantages to keeping everything consolidated. And we are very close, maybe within a week or something, to, I don't know, to having a new milestone sort of thing on the site where you can say you're watching a project, and then you'll get email updates so that it'll say, you know, somebody replied to your comment, you can go to the site and see it. you can certainly sign up on the site, you can read stuff, you can go on discussions, and most of the stuff we do is actually on IRC right now. It's freenode.net, and it's just Snowdrift. But yeah, then like we, the other part, blog. This was for a small bootstrap group. I'm behind on doing the Chrome or something for the blog that David wants me to do, so that we can like put up the blog thing that will be integrated with everything. But at the very least, all the work that we've done is going to be available to everybody else. So anybody who has a project that signs up on the site, if they didn't have the blogging thing already, well, the site will have a blog so they can use it there if they want.
I like your concept. This is all very sensible. But I use an awful lot of free software things, and in principle, there's hundreds of projects I ought to give 3 cents to.
Sure.
And how do you deal with, but it's going to be a bit tedious going through your web interface, saying, yeah, I'll give you 3 cents, and I'll give you one, and I'll give you a whole dollar, and whatever.
Sure.
How do you deal with that kind of diffusivity problem?
So,
is it just hard?
So I don't have a perfect solution right now, except that we're, in terms of building a community, we want to get more people who are actively involved. So we're not totally, like there's pros and cons to something that involves a little more active connection. There's some pros to telling people, go to the site, look at what the project's doing, see what the updates are, be conscious of this, be involved, not encouraging the most amount of passivity. But we don't want to create artificial obstacles. We certainly want things to go as smoothly as possible. Joey actually helped us with the very first version of having a little bit for our API, which will be a little thing you can put on your site that'll say, there are this many people currently pledged to support this project, and you, whoever's looking at the site, when you pledge, these people will add more to support us. And you could just click pledge, and it would go right to the page, and you'd say, pledge. But you'd have to have an account on the site, overall. But there's also the level of, I'm not sure that we expect people to, or even asking people to donate to every single project they ever use. Although somebody who really wants to could do that.
There's a sort of infrastructure people who tend never to get, they're not very interesting. Who wants to pay the util Linux people?
Right.
But we all need that stuff. Where does it come from?
I will say this: we're definitely building the system, and again, because of the sort of downstream community focus, the mission is to focus on downstream user-facing projects. So the most popular, most obvious types of things, you can support Inkscape or whatever else. And then if they use a bunch of libraries, the premise is if you can get a bunch of funding to the downstream projects, they should donate it upstream to the projects that, they make decisions about just funding the things they rely on.
Just relaying a comment from IRC. Steven C99 says that kickstarting Debian LTS sounds just like the problem, the prisoner's dilemma or the Snowdrift dilemma.
Can you speak up just a little bit? Sorry.
The bootstrapping the Debian LTS effort seems just like that. So if you don't have enough committed funding, then it's not going ahead.
Could somebody try to explain that?
Yeah.
Put in a question for me.
So the point here, I'm not super in Debian, you're not familiar with it. So the point is that lots of people use Debian, and we basically support it for a couple of years, and then after that we've got new stuff to build and we move on. But there's a lot of people who quite like it to be supported for 10 years or whatever, but they're a very diffuse interest. Somebody has to do that work, and there's probably lots of people who would like that work done, but it's never managed to coalesce to the point where there's actually some funding for the people to do the really rather boring job of backporting things to ancient
software. I would say one of the reasons that one of the questions I get often is something along the lines of, wait a minute, so some project gets pretty popular and they get a lot of the funds because they get all the matching things and they use up people's budget or something, what happens to these other projects or that type of thing? And part of the answer is, we're okay with the idea that this is a democratic way to kind of funnel funds in certain directions. So there may be things that people really want, like a really long-term support from Debian, But it's a question of how many people really support that and whether the economics is actually feasible. And so if there aren't enough people who are willing to put their money to making that happen, I would say that, I'm sorry, the economics aren't there to support it. It's not our fault, we're not gonna make that happen. And maybe the limited funds that people have in the world need to go to something else. But the main issue is that right now we have the snowdrift dilemma. So all of those individual people, however many there are, one of them could say, I want this to happen, I'm gonna put in my $200, and it doesn't happen anyway, because it doesn't do anything. You have to have everybody, as a society, we have to decide we're gonna put money towards that, or it's not gonna go ahead. And there has to be somebody, of course, who's willing to say, I will do the work if you fund me. And so we are helping to facilitate that existing, but there's sort of a test of it's, and we're okay with this. If people want to support all sorts of different projects, they can, and in the end, you won't end up donating to the thing, even the thing you really like, you won't donate to, unless other people are with you, because you're contingent on having other people come and pledge with you. And that's good, because your money would have been wasted. It's a risk to donate to things that are going to end up failing anyway.
I think in the case of the Debian long-term support issue, it's that particular project needs a slightly different funding model because it has a different community of users of it. You know, unlike something where like the example that you the music software example that you gave earlier, where that's used by a lot of individuals kind of around the world, you know, who can in aggregate come up with a fair amount of funding for that project. In the case of Debian long-term support, I think what we would find is that there are a relatively few large users of that project who could fund the project by contributing a larger amount of money, you know, on,
sure.
You know, like organizations that are using it and things along those lines, as opposed to a whole bunch of individuals
making use of it. I agree with you, and I should just say, first off, of course, actually we're running out of time, but I should also say, please come talk to me, because we have looked into all these things, and I might have, like in this case, I do have an answer for you. I thought about that question before, but don't assume that we know everything. I would love to hear your feedback. I'd love to hear about, you know, real on-the-ground situations that we're trying to, that will affect our decisions. I would like to see long-term a institutional level that we could have on the site. So instead of saying individual people, say entities like schools or something, this entire school district says, we would love to have free software that did this for our students, or we would love to have this textbook to use in our classes, that's free open educational resources. But we as a school can only put in so much, and if we just do, it won't pay enough to make it worthwhile. So we will make a pledge to this project on snowdrift.coop and say, however many other school districts that will, you know, or other entities that will make a pledge that is at the institutional level, then we will add that much more from our budget. That seems more complicated, certainly not what we're going to launch with. I don't actually know it'll ever get there, but I see the same economic issue at that level.
Suggestion for when you are presenting the system, it would be really nice to have example figures of if one person says it's going to give 1 cent for every other person that joins, this much goes to the project in these many months.
So
it makes it clear to have a clear picture of
definitely
how feasible it is.
One of the things we're working on that's a top priority among other top priorities is to have a system in which we can actually have a graph or something. Right now you can pledge with fake money, so you can say that you can add fake money to your account, you can make a pledge, you can see what the result is, and we don't present right now enough of the stuff telling you, this pledge will make this effect, this pledge will make this effect, and sort of showing it in the aggregate, but that's easy enough for us to add. Certainly anybody who wants to do a little bit of Haskell and help us add that, we can use the help. There's other, if you're not a Haskell learner, there's all sorts of other things we could do too, design and front-end things or JavaScript enhancements. But anyway, we've actually been teaching. There's been a handful of volunteers who want to help us and then didn't know Haskell and have been learning Haskell just in order to help us. But that's a separate thing. But I'll give you, just to give you a concrete example, which will help end it for now. The current proposal on a technical level is that the minimum pledge is a tenth of a cent per other patron. And what that means is that if everybody is at the minimum, then if there's 1,000 people with me, I'll put in my dollar, and you'll have $1,000 a month to fund somebody part-time. If there's 5,000 people with me, I put in my $5, and then we have $25,000 a month. So that gives you a sense of how it scales. But not everybody wants to just be at the minimum, and people are of different means. So our proposal is to have a system in which you can pledge multiple shares. And if you pledge multiple shares, we have a logarithmic scale where other people will match your extra shares, but at a tapering off level. So if you pledge 8 shares or something, then it'll count as though there's like, that's, you know, 2 to the 3rd power sort of. So you can think of it as like, it counts as though there were 3 more people coming in to pledge with you. I think we actually did a boost just for the first level, so it's actually 4. But basically, if you pledge like 1,000 shares because you're some super rich person, then you're saying, I will put in this enormous amount for every additional person who pledges with me, even when they're at a small level. But those people don't have to match your crazy huge pledge. So we can still have people at different levels, but we're still encouraging people to say, when you pledge a little extra beyond the minimum, the rest of the community will still say, like, thanks, you know, and put in a little extra as well. But we need to make some clear graphs and things presenting it. We need to have a actual history. And when projects are actually on the site, you can see how it's working, and we'll see.
I think the Kickstarter killer feature is the fact that there's this threshold, and so people are often very likely to say, yeah, you know, I'll join into that thing, and if it doesn't get over the threshold, nothing is lost. But if it does, that means lots of people are interested, and then it will happen.
Right.
I like the model you're talking about how it kind of has this snowball effect as it grows, although I think people might be risk adverse of, what if it gets really popular and now I've just committed to funding? So do you have anything like a cap?
Yeah, the proposal is to have a cap in the system, like Flatter. Basically, you say, it's not exactly like Flatter, but we may adapt to some legal problems depending upon what our proposal is, but basically you put it, you know, you can say, here's $100 I put into the system, and, you know, that's that. The system is drawing just from your allotment that you've got, and that's your budget. If you run out of funds, then we say, well, your pledge isn't active anymore, you'll have to add funds if you want to stay active. The reason that I don't want to do like a per project, I'm opposed to this, but various people like the idea, and there's room to adapt. But I don't like the idea of, I will give this much exactly, you know, here's my cap for this project or something like that, because I see that as destroying some of the game issues here. It says to other people, if we have that, they know that I have some cap, and they, maybe if they don't even know what it is, it's like, oh, well, it doesn't really matter, because when I pledge, like, somebody's going to just hit their cap and it won't make any difference. They won't actually match me. So it doesn't, it gets weirder with that. And I think of it as the fact that I don't actually have any good idea what's good to donate to a project. I personally, like, there's no way I know that it makes sense to donate $10 or $15 or $50. Like, I mean, unless I'm actually starving, I have some money in the bank, like, I can worry about next year whether I'll be broke or not, you know, and how much I can donate today. But people aren't good at judging these things at all. And so, like, if you go to an auction, you have this situation where you say, like, I paid this much for this random thing. And then somebody else outbids you and go, I guess it's worth more. Maybe I should really outbid it. No, I still want it. I'm going to bid this much. So we really want it to be sort of flexible. And the overall idea is that you have a cap in the system, and it's just you're making a certain amount of funds available. We're not going to put you in debt, you know, and say, like, it got to whatever level. But that's the proposal for now. And I know that some things, that's one of them in the system, is challenging some people's assumptions right now. I run into a lot of people who say, the market makes these decisions, and there's prices, and it works like this, and I know that I would pay this much for this. But I don't think that's true. I just think people have a certain certain assumptions about how the economy works that may not be how they actually behave.
Having done the Kickstarter thing myself and a follow-up, it definitely can be used for free software, but what I quickly found is there's no sustainability in that model, and you know that you have people who want to support you, but you can't just keep doing this crazy thing where you have to go do a lot of work just to, you know, go through the process again, and after a while it would just become absurd. And so, you know, I really like that this is pointing toward more sustainability and also toward finding an actual value between different, an economic value between different things, you know, in some interesting ways. So that's why I'm really interested.
Thanks so much. I will add very quickly, we have actually a page on the site about what we think is wrong with the Kickstarter model and why it's not working so well for free software. And I'll add that my personal complaint is I really hate ads. I don't like the big hype, you know, everything's in your face sort of thing, and I think Kickstarter is just like more ads from more people. It's like, it just encourages that culture, and I would rather a system in which everything is clear, everybody can access information on the site, see how honorable they are and what they're doing for the people, and it's free, you just use it, and if you use it, support it. And I don't really want to see more money going to fancy videos and marketing and all of that, even though there's something to it still. I don't like that, personally.
The organization that I work for, the best possible thing for us is for people to sign up with a regular donation that occurs monthly. We do an annual fundraising drive, and that certainly brings in a lot of money as well, and we, you know, are always going to do both of those things, but in terms of ongoing funding. So if you considered, or you're going to build into the system some way where instead of putting in static amounts at one time, people just automatically have a monthly amount go in?
Yeah, that would be certainly as things sort of stabilize and we see how things are going. Certainly saying you deposit a certain amount monthly into the system is fine. Obviously, the system that lives alongside any of the other fundraising systems that exist, and people can use Kickstarter or one-time campaigns when that's appropriate, because that has a place where it's serving a different niche. But I guess I'd say that one of the ways I like to explain the system, if I have like, you know, quick elevator speech, I don't pick between like a bunch of different approaches, but one thing is Kickstarter has this assurance contract, the collective action issue, and matching pledges are a really powerful thing in traditional fundraising. I donate to NPR when there's some, you know, matching funds to claim, that type of thing. But sustaining pledges, a normal ongoing membership fee, is the other like most important robust thing in fundraising, and we're just combining all of those. That's what the system is. It's all of those at once. So anyway, thanks everybody for showing up, and thanks for, please come talk to me later and check out the site and come see us on IRC and come help us make this reality. It's a lot of work, but I wish I had more to say. It was already operating now, but we're getting there. We keep working on it. Thanks.